The next item of business is portfolio question time. Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And at question number one, I call Annabel Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with Historic Environment Scotland about the reopening of assets in the Cowdenbeath constituency.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Swift transition. I have regular discussions with Historic Environment Scotland about the health and safety challenges of Scotland's properties in care. As regards to the Cowdenbeath constituency, I understand that the main castle area of Aberdour Castle remain fenced until a tactile inspection has been completed. However, Historic Environment Scotland is aiming to have some areas of the site reopened to the public as soon as possible. Historic Environment Scotland would be more than happy to offer Annabel Ewing a site visit to learn firsthand from the experts about the situation there.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Minister for his helpful answer. In fact, it's not just parts of Aberdour Castle that are closed to the public and have been so since the outset of the pandemic, but also Inchcombe Abbey and St Bridget's Kirk in Dalgetty Bay. And obviously this is impacting negatively on the local economy. So whilst I would of course take up an opportunity to meet with Historic Environment Scotland, I would also ask the Minister to use his good offices to ensure that all three sites are opened as soon as possible and to provide a bit of clarity perhaps as to what as soon as possible actually might mean.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank Annabel Ewing for her question and for the way that she is advocating quite rightly, and I would expect nothing less from her on behalf of her constituents and her constituency. I recognise the impact of access restrictions at historic sites on local businesses and communities, as Annabel Ewing has rightly outlined, and I share absolutely the frustrations of the members and our constituents regarding continued closures. As I'm sure we all accept, the safety of visitors and his staff must take priority, and I will pass the members' specific concerns to Historic Environment Scotland, including about community engagement. HES is working hard to prioritise the most effective sites in the inspection schedule and to keep public access open where it is safe to do so. I'm pleased to see that some sites have now partially opened, such as Duncastle, this week, but recognise that there is further to go in the members' constituency. And I thank Annabel Ewing again for her points.
Question number two, Alexander Burnett.
Thank the Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of its overseas offices.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Presiding Officer, Scotland's international network creates domestic opportunities, attracts investment and ultimately benefits the people of Scotland. I'm pleased to see the cross-party enthusiasm on the excellent job that Scotland's international offices do on a day-to-day basis. Within the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee's recent report on the Scottish Government's international work, and building on my response to the committee's report on the 6th of June, I'll be following up with the committee in the coming weeks in greater detail on the work our international offices are currently doing and what they will be focused on in the months ahead.
Alexander Burnett.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer? Whilst I recognise that the Scottish Government's overseas offices perform a function in seeking to promote Scottish businesses and culture abroad, the fact is the SNP Government appear to be misusing this resource in order to pursue a distinct foreign policy from the rest of the UK and to discuss independence with foreign governments, all at taxpayers' expense. So can the Minister confirm whether he's met with foreign governments to discuss independence, and if so, on how many occasions?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to Alistair Burnett, firstly, I think he would benefit from actually visiting some of the offices. I don't know if he's been to any or if he's spoken to any of the staff in the offices, if he's satisfied himself about what they have been doing. They are highly professional representatives of Scotland. They benefit the economy of Scotland. They benefit in terms of inward investment. They promote the culture of Scotland. They promote Scotland's relations with the rest of the world. And I think they do a tremendous job. If I, as Cabinet Secretary or other ministers of the Scottish Government, hold conversations with others, of course we discuss the policy of the government. That's what we've been elected to do. But please, don't seek to undermine the professionalism and the effectiveness of Scottish Government offices around the world. It really isn't worthy.
Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The latest Ernst & Young Scotland Attractiveness Survey showed Scotland leading the way in the UK when it comes to securing foreign direct investment, in spite of the significant challenges posed by Brexit and the pandemic. Given the findings of the report, can the Cabinet Secretary provide any further information about the work which the offices are undertaking to attract investment to Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I thank my colleague for the sensible question. The EY results are fantastic for Scotland, and they underline the strength of our inward investment offer, with the growth in Scotland's FDI performance outpacing Europe and the rest of the UK. Scotland has maintained its position as the UK's most attractive FDI location outside London for 9 of the last 11 years and for the 7th year running. The Scottish Government and its delivery partners, SDI and SE, will continue to focus support on attracting the high-quality inward investment required to deliver our ambitions in areas such as energy transition, focusing on ScotWind and hydrogen, space, decarbonisation of transport, and Scotland's international network is vital in supporting this work, and the Scottish Government will continue to promote and showcase our world-leading capabilities on the international stage at events such as Dubai Expo, COP26 and the World Forum for FDI.
Question number 3, Russell Findlay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on Scotland's Census 2022.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Following the end of the census collect period, National Records of Scotland are now focused on planned post-collection quality control and assurance work, which includes the Census Coverage Survey, the second largest social research exercise in Scotland after the census itself. NRS are confident that the national return rate and coverage across the country, coupled with aforementioned post-collection quality control and assurance work, will provide a credible, high-quality census output. NRS are working with a number of statisticians and global experts in census and administrative data to help steer the statistical and methodological work of NRS over the next few months.
Russell Findlay.
I want to begin by sincerely thanking the Cabinet Secretary, who is a very important MSP indeed, for providing a humble member like myself with that answer, so thank you. Presiding Officer, trains, ferries, Rangers prosecutions, trams, Prestwick, BIFAB, NHS disasters, policing scandals and now the SNP's shambolic census. Hard-working Scots always end up footing the bill for the SNP's world-beating incompetence. Can the Cabinet Secretary tell them whether he or anyone else will pay the price for this £30 million census debacle?
Cabinet Secretary.
Forgive me, I'm not sure if what number the member was talking to there in the peroration to his speech, but the increase in census costs to raise the return rate from the 70s to 88% constituted 4% of the budget for this census round. Frankly, that is, relatively speaking, an affordable and reasonable rate of return to raise the census return rate to provide a solid foundation, which is what the experts have described it as. And I think given that all public services rely on a census and a return rate which provides such a solid foundation, that we should all take the opportunity to thank the 2.3 million households that took part in the census and the great many people who worked, including the hundreds, over 1,000 people who worked as enumerators, particularly in the last month, to ensure we have secured the solid foundation which independent international experts have described it as being.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, while some of the rhetoric in this chamber will draw attention away from the fact, it is, as you mentioned, important to acknowledge that 2.3 million households did return the census, an enormous proportion of the population, and the data collected in this immense exercise will deliver very real and tangible advances in the delivery of local public services. Can the Cabinet Secretary put on record some examples of how census data directly translates into inclusive service planning for Scotland's communities?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I thank the member for that question? It remains the best way to gather vital information which government, councils, the NHS and a range of users in the public, private and third sectors need. The results help local authorities, businesses and government plan a wide range of vital public services to improve the lives of those living and working in Scotland. The information that has been collected from the census helps us understand who stays in Scotland, who they stay with, what sort of accommodation they stay in, And this allows decisions to be made about where money is spent in local communities on things like schools where our children are educated, roads that we drive on every day, and healthcare that we rely on. The census is a very important piece of work, and I'm delighted that it has reached the return rate that it has, given the challenges through the census collect period.
Question number 4, Willie Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government what its policy is for the currency of an independent Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scotland will continue to use the pound sterling at the point of independence, establishing an independent Scottish currency as soon as is practicably possible through a careful, managed and responsible transition when an independent Scottish Parliament chooses to do so.
Yep. Willie Rennie.
I too am honoured that the Minister has felt able to answer my question. In 2014, the policy of the SNP was a monetary union. Now Ian Blackford wants sterlingisation. But the SNP conference rejected the leadership's position, describing it as a dangerous experiment. Coalition partner Lorna Slater said it would be catastrophic. Patrick Harvey said it would prevent Scotland from joining the EU. Alex Salmond wants a Scottish pound. Alan Smith wants the euro. The independence movement is like two bald bankers fighting over a 50 pence piece. If they can't agree on the currency, why on earth should the public?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, there's literally no answer that I could give to Willie Rennie that would satisfy him. We are on different sides of the independence debate. If we can't agree on that, at least it would be nice for us to be able to agree as Democrats that this is an issue that the people should be able to decide on.
Yep.
Question number 5, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is regarding the potential impact on Scotland on the upcoming first meeting of states parties to the UN Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons in Vienna.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government is on record supporting the principles of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons and have welcomed countries, including Ireland, ratifying the treaty. However, Scotland will not be able to share our views and support like-minded partners at this first meeting of the state parties to the treaty in Vienna later this month, which is due to be opened by the UN Secretary General. Scotland is not a sovereign, independent country yet. UK opposition to the treaty means they've chosen not to attend as observers. Only with independence can Scotland's interests be properly represented on the international stage.
Bill Kidd.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Now, it's long established that an independent Scotland will be free of nuclear weapons on the basis that these indiscriminate weapons of mass destruction and mass murder are morally abhorrent and should in no circumstances be used. Despite the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons making the use and stockpiling of these weapons illegal, as mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary, the UK Government is not engaging in this first meeting of states parties in Vienna at the UN next week. I'll be attending as part of ICANN's Parliamentarians for the TPNW delegation, ensuring a Scottish voice is heard and position on this consequential matter and can be heard. Can the Minister, Cabinet Secretary, advise, in the case of an independent Scotland, how quickly this country will join the TPNW?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I share my colleague's disappointment that the UK Government is not engaging with this important process. I understand that a number of countries which are not parties to the treaty, including NATO member states, will be attending as observers, and I welcome this commitment to multilateralism and a willingness to engage on these crucial issues. I'm also glad to hear that the member will join a delegation of parliamentarians in Vienna. As the First Minister and I have said this week, the Scottish Government will be publishing further papers setting out the prospectus for independence, and this will include our position on treaties.
Question number 6, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what contribution local culture evidenced in museums such as the Tremonti Museum in Melrose and the National Mining Museum Scotland in Newton Grange makes to the local and wider Scottish economy.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Tremontium Museum and National Mining Museum are fine examples of how this cultural sector can contribute to both the local and wider economy. I recently attended the official opening of the refurbished Tremontium Museum and viewed their fine collection of items from the Roman and Iron Age, and was able to thank the trustees for their incredible work at the museum. I look forward to visiting the National Mining Museum, which is home to around 95,000 items of national significance, attracting 48,000 visitors each year and generating £1.3 million to the local economy. The Scottish Government continues to provide core funding to Museums and Galleries Scotland, which supports 430 museums and galleries across Scotland.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for his reply. Minister, very small communities such as in Tweedsmuir, high in the Borders Hills, can make a huge difference to the regeneration of their communities. Is the Minister aware of the regeneration of the Crook Inn, closed in 2006 after more than 400 years of continuous operation, which is being done in phases, the first being the Wee Crook, a licensed bistro, which will certainly boost that local economy? And would he accept an invitation from me to see the project for himself, not necessarily to go to the licensed bit, but just to visit the project?
Minister?
I've never spared the fun with Christine Graham. I think it was a previous question that I actually took the invitation from Christine to go to Trimontium, and I was very grateful to accept her hospitality and to be able to go along to the reopening with her on that special occasion. And I agree that historic properties such as the Crook Inn in Tweedsmuir are really important to local heritage and a community's sense of place. And if Christine Graham would like to write to me with the further details, I'd be more than happy to consider that very generous invitation that she's made. And I look forward to learning more about the restoration of this historic building and the tremendous work undertaken by the local community.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Christine Graham makes a good point, but all too often, cultural spending is the first thing that gets cut by councils when funds are tight. For example, in Midlothian, Christine Graham's own area, the SNP Council have cut museum and galleries funding from £83,000 a year in 2016-17 to £10,000 in 2020-21. It's the same story in other SNP councils like East Ayrshire or Glasgow. How does the Minister expect our culture sector to grow locally when SNP councils are slashing culture spending across Scotland?
Minister.
With reference, of course, to the Trimontium Museum in Melrose and the National Mining Museum in Newton Grange, I have regular conversations with local authority culture conveners. I'm hoping to be able to see them again once they're reappointed, in order that I can make sure that we have a partnership approach to ensuring that our culture offering is strong, and ensure that we are able to work together to ensure that our shared priorities around ensuring that people are able to enjoy our cultural facilities for both the community economic well-being, but also our own personal well-being as we recover from the pandemic.
Question number 7, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what priority it attaches to developing relationships with other European countries.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, and may I thank Liam MacArthur for the question. The Scottish Government attaches a high priority to developing relationships with other European countries, which is why we want to rejoin the European Union, and that is only possible by Scotland becoming an independent country. Our recently published Global Affairs Framework sets out the values and principles underpinning the Scottish Government's international work and the basis on which the Scottish Government will prioritise its European and wider international activity. The Scottish Government will continue to take a positive and proactive role in engaging with European partners on shared challenges and opportunities, where Scotland is well placed to offer expertise and share best practice.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary? The Erasmus programme is a fantastic initiative which allowed us to forge relationships with our European friends and open the world for Scottish universities and Scottish students. It was a needless casualty of Brexit. However, the Welsh Government have already committed £65 million to their scheme, with young people from Wales preparing to go abroad from September. Assuming he believes that I have a sufficient electoral mandate, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to confirm if the Scottish scheme will be up and running for the next academic year, or will thousands of young Scots continue to miss out on the opportunities of a lifetime?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Liam MacArthur for that follow-up, as I have indicated in answers to his colleague from North East Fife. The loss of the Erasmus programme is indeed a tragedy. Its replacement is something that has been a matter of discussion between the Scottish Government and the Commission, and we will continue to make progress in that, because I hope, I think, we're all agreed that we need to do everything that we can do to ensure that young people from Scotland, but other young people from the European continent, are able to continue in the educational exchange that existed while we were part of the European Union. And perhaps it might give him cause to consider that the best future for Scotland is to re-establish all of the established programmes with the European Union. And the only way of doing that is by rejoining the European Union. I'd be delighted to welcome him as part of that campaign.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the best ways to develop relationship with their European countries is through educational ties. When my colleagues have recently asked the Scottish Government about delays to replacement for Erasmus, we have been told that the plan for Scotland to instead rejoin the EU. But while the Scottish Government waits for this theoretical solution, thousands of very real students are missing out on educational opportunities in Europe. They are limiting the opportunities of a generation in their gamble on a future EU membership that they cannot guarantee. Why can the Scottish Government not follow the example of the Welsh Labour Government and bring forward a replacement for Erasmus now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say firstly, it's disappointing because I think it was only this week that we had confirmation from the British Labour Party that they were not going to seek the membership of the European Union for the United Kingdom. And I think that disappoints a great many, and perhaps even some on Faisal Chowdhury's own benches, perhaps even himself. Yeah. I already gave an answer to his Liberal Democrat colleague behind in relation to the Erasmus scheme in particular. He talks about Scotland rejoining the European Union and theoretical opportunities. Can I say to Faisal Chowdhury, this is not a theoretical opportunity. If one is a member state of the European Union, one can, with great ease, play a full part in the Erasmus programme. And perhaps he's one of those on the Labour benches that actually represents the 30% of Labour voters that are in favour of Scottish independence, and he can join us in the campaign when the referendum is underway.
Mm-hmm. Question number 8, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has now published all of the legal advice it has received in relation to a second independence referendum.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've released the legal advice required under Commissioner's decision as it does not merit the time and expense required for an appeal. Although we disagree with the decision, we've published precisely what the Commissioner specified, and in line with the Ministerial Code, I do not intend to comment on the content of other legal advice.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Well, I'm kind of grateful for that reply. The Information Commissioner's ruling, Presiding Officer, about this couldn't have been clearer. In it, he states, and I quote, that a second independence referendum in Scotland is of significant public interest for a substantial portion of the Scottish population. He goes on that the request to release it should be considered one of the exceptional circumstances which outweighs the inbuilt public interest in maintaining the exemption on confidentiality. Presiding Officer, he was not talking about the legal advice as to whether the government could road test a question with the Electoral Commission. He was talking about the central legality around the propositions open to the Scottish Parliament, or the Scottish Government rather, in pursuing its objective of holding an independence referendum next year. Does the Cabinet Secretary not realise that by withholding that central legality and that legal advice, he is holding not only the Information Commissioner in contempt, but in this Parliament in contempt as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I've already made clear, in line with the Ministerial Code, I do not intend to comment on the content of other legal advice. This is a position, incidentally, that's been held by Liberal Democrat ministers in this Parliament and by Liberal Democrat ministers at Westminster. I have no plans to depart from that position today.